suffering we greet. So many lonely faces scattered all around, searching for what they need. Is this the world we created? What did we do it for? Is this the world we invaded? Against love, so it seems in the end. Is this what we're all living for today? The world that we created. You know that every day a helpless child is born.
Queen had written and recorded "Is This the World We Created" before Live Aid was thought up, so it was very appropriate for them to be playing at this globally minded event, which followed in the spirit of their song.
I traced them all the way down to some, I can't remember where it was some tiny little beach that, or some little small seaside resort they were staying at, or Jim was staying at. And I said, oh, for Christ's sake, you know, I mean, you know, what's wrong with him? And he said, well, you know, I mean, he's very sensitive. and I said, you know, like, I mean, tell the old faggot that it's going to be the biggest thing that ever, what's it, you know, happened, and that it's going to be like, you know, this huge mega thing. And so they got back and said, okay, we're definitely doing it. I thought, great. And then when they did do Live Aid, they were absolutely, I think, the best band of the day. You know, whatever your personal taste is irrelevant. When the day came, they played the best, they had the best sound, they used their 17 minutes or whatever to the best. I mean, they understood the idea exactly, that it was a global jukebox, as I described it. I mean, I was actually upstairs in the appeals box on Wembley Stadium, and a guy on the phone had just given me £1 million, this guy from Kuwait. And he just said, Mr. Geloff, the people of Kuwait want to give you £1 million. I said, thanks very much. And I put down the phone and I went outside and I heard this sound. You know, I thought, God, who's got the sound together? And it was Queen. And like, I just looked down over this crowd of people just going crazy.
In fact, probably never. But I think it was the greatest day of our lives, even though we played only a very small part in it. I think it's the thing I'll remember above all out of what we've done in our career. It's amazing, amazing day.
We walked out there, just the four of us, no sound check, no lights, and the response we got was very, you know, it was, we didn't, you know, we it hit us a bit that day. As like weeks afterwards, we realised, you know, how successful it was.
We knew why we were there. You know, the reason was to feed those kids who otherwise were going to die. And seeing as we were there, we were going to do the best job we could.
I didn't realise that we'd gone down quite as well as we'd gone down until Elton came up and said, "You stole the show," or something like that. I thought he was being nice, you know. All we hear is Radio Gaga.
Participation. I love that most of all. And I like singing my songs, or our songs, but most of all I like the audience to actually feel that they're virtually part of the show. So, I mean, when they sing, you know, I love it.
Freddie really rose to the occasion, and he's good in those kind of situations where most people tend to get a bit nervous and dry up. Freddie kind of seems to gain an extra dimension, and he was wonderful. I thought he just had him in the palm of his hand.
Freddie in particular was delighted he did it. It was the perfect stage for him, the whole world. You know, and then he could pounce about on stage, you know, doing We Are the Champions, you know. And
I've taken my bath in my curtain crowns. You brought me fame and fortune, everything that goes with it. I thank you all. But it's been a bed of roses.
What they did for us was give us confidence back, because we were sort of feeling a bit, I don't know if trapped is the right word, but we felt we were on this sleigh ride and what was going to come next. And we'd actually said, okay, we don't want to do anything for a while. And when we did Live Aid without our usual show, without the lights and the usual sound and everything, and still found that we were able to play and get our music across, I think it gave us a bit more confidence in what we were.
The confidence instilled in the band by their Live Aid appearance galvanized them into embarking upon their biggest tour ever. Life on the road with Queen means 6 months of planning, an 80-page instruction booklet, 13 trucks carrying 100 tons of technical hardware, 19 limousines, and a road crew of 40 people.
Dust. Another one.
the 60s, it was more, well, we're going to go on tour, and we'll jump in the car and go on tour. You know, it was, but now everything is, everybody's got computers and this and that, and it's become very, very businesslike. It's like feeding the monster, you know. Yes.
Much better that way. It's like a big toy for us, you know, it's like boys with toys, because you have the opportunity to do whatever you want on that stage, you know, and we have the best people, the best technicians, and we say we want this to happen here and this to happen there, and they say okay, we find a way.
It'd be a very big stage. You need a golf cart to get from one side to the other, I think.
They wonder what I'm doing there. I wonder the same.
I remember once when we had, it was the last tour, when one of the songs was I Want to Break Free, where during the show, Freddie would dress up as a woman. And we had on the customs document, we had, I think, 40 or 50 pairs of breasts, which he needed spares, and, you know, they wore out somehow. And so the customs officer saw this on the carne and wanted to know what they were. And we said, well, they're, you know, it's 50 pairs of breasts. So he insisted on seeing them. And, of course, they're right at the front of the truck, so we have to unload, and we lay out 50 pairs of breasts. And there we are. They're on the carne, and he's happy, but it causes a two-hour delay. So when we get to the concert, why are you late? Well, the breasts were inspected.
Very demanding, difficult, tough people behind them who drive us crazy. But nevertheless, they always deliver. And when it comes to the show, they're one of the best. I mean, their production is always terrific. They always deliver.
Actually had quite a wide age range. I mean, apart from the fact that we've actually been doing it for so long and we've grown up through it all. You know, I mean, people who started out the same age as us when we started, you know, early 20s and whatever, still, we have some that still follow us. We've also picked up a lot of younger people as well as we've gone along. Bring back that Leroy Brown. Bring back both the modified front stage show.
Tickets for the entire Magic Tour sold out the day they went on sale, breaking all previous records.
I've been so Queen programs. Don't wait till after the show, because we'll be sold out.
Who are the people who packed out Wembley Stadium two nights running?
I think I'm mentally addicted to the sound of Freddie's voice. If I go for more than about 8 hours at a stretch without listening to him, I start to go crazy.
Are you gonna take me home tonight? Oh, down beside that red firelight. Oh, you gonna let it all hang out, fat bottom girls? You make the rocking world go round.
And you got all these women trying to make dates with you, you know, it's terrible that, and which we mustn't allow in our job. You know, we must have the women coming up saying, would you like to come to my house so they can get a backstage pass? We don't allow anything like that, you know.
Oh,
before I do a tour, I have to actually really think about it a lot, and then I have to do exercises and really train and get into a very good, you know, get into a good state of, I have to be really together to actually walk on stage. I can't just say, okay, let's do it tomorrow.
Now, no more of you camera people. Keep away from me. This is the king!
Once you're on tour, I like to get on and do it. I don't like to be hanging around on tour. I like to win as much as you can, cover the ground, and do as well as you can, because you can build up this great rhythm and you get into the mood and the feel of playing, and you play better each night, I think. You know, if you see us at the end of a tour, we're a lot different from what we are at the beginning of a tour always, because we're in that rhythm.
Backstage at a Queen show means big shots, famous friends, and of course family.
Not mine, but very beautiful.
We did it. We arrived. This is Lorinda. Have you met Lorinda?
No. She's got
a bar. Yeah. Energetic behaviour betrays those pre-show nerves. To release the mounting tension, the celebrities joke amongst themselves.
I was one of the young punks who were coming up who'd sort of dismiss Queen. But you have to go through those things. I think at the end of the day, what transcends fashion and style is quality.
I mean, they've always been a very clever band. They've always been very talented, and they've always approached music very intelligently. Probably because they've all got so many degrees and they're all so well educated and everything.
I like Freddie's.
I like his music, but he doesn't turn me on.
It's instant, orgasmic, concentrated energy.
Proof is in the pudding, isn't it? I mean, how long has Kiss, listen to me, has Queen been around? For Kiss, Queen, it's all the same thing. But how long have they been around for a long time? You know? And the only way that you stay around for a long time is if you still sell tickets. And they still sell tickets, and they still sell a lot of records. So they must be good.
To me, they fall into the same category as the Stones. They are totally recognizable. 100%. As soon as you hear a Queen record, you know it's a Queen record.
I really can't compare, you know, a group of musicians on that level, because it's a matter of the media, really, and how you're perceived, you know. I mean, I'm not really Keith Richards. At least not the one that everybody thinks I am. I mean, you know, it's a ball and chain. An image is like a shadow, you know. It's always behind you a little bit.
Oh, Freddie would be very pleased about being called the next Mick Jagger. I don't think he'd really like that. If you're watching, Freddie.
afraid when I come off stage to actually be myself, which is, you know, that can be very, very boring and mundane. But most people, and in fact, quite a lot of people, when they meet me, they're quite disillusioned. The fact that they expect me to actually just do what I do on stage, and I'm a human being, you know, and I'd like people to realize the fact that I'm a human being.
This post-Wembley rave up at the Roof Gardens, Queen parties are extravagant events with extravagant guests.
Yes, I think, I mean, if you want fame and you get fame, you have to accept the fact that you are public property, more or less. And each stage, you become more professional at it, you know, and you tend in the end not to go out and just sort of keep yourself to yourself. And you lose a lot of the normality out of life in this business completely. And Freddie, I mean, Freddie's got no idea what an egg costs or anything like that. I mean, absolutely hopeless. You ask Freddie how much a pint of milk is, forget it. He'll be able to tell you the price of nail lacquer.
Does things with a mic. If it is a woman who did things with a mic like that, they'd ban her and say this is sexist.
I'm just a musical prostitute.
Freddie Mercury just does things with a mic. If it is a woman who did things with a mic like that, they'd ban her and say this is sexist.
I'm just a musical prostitute, my dear.
And you think God is sexy. You should have ruined it. You should have ruined it.
Oh, I like that Freddie, but he was not a queen though, but I like him.
We get enough of life on the road and life in studios to want to have our private lives apart from that. And I think you almost become, not exactly two different people, but it's a very different world and you have to acclimatize, you know. So I think when we're on tour, we live a touring life and it's fun. It's not all glamorous, but it's fun, you know. And when you go home, you have your everyday problems. You have your wife and your family. I don't mean that's a problem. I mean, you know, you have bills to pay and you have to have a semblance of normality. And I think it's a very good thing, otherwise you go crazy. If you're permanently on tour and permanently adored and expected to be something special, then you would go nuts.
That cold sober, baby left me for somebody new. I don't want to talk about it, want to forget about it, want to be intoxicated with that special brew. So come and get me, let me get in that sinking feeling that says my heart is on an all-time low. So on.
longer the day goes, the more I feel exhausted. But Queen keeps my spirit young, so I can suffer with my body quite long.
Melancholy blues.
If I had to do this every day, forget it.
There's a party afterwards, by the way.
Because we don't know what we were going to want to do, and we just do really what we want to do, what we feel like doing.
Last 2 or 3 years, I think we realized that get to a point where things aren't going to be totally new anymore unless you consciously make them new, you know. So we search within ourselves to get new material, and we still go to new places. I mean, we're going to Budapest for the first time this time, which is new and exciting.
Dejte do Československa, dejte do Československa, Queen k nám, do Československa, no, no, no.
I want to see Queen concert, but I haven't ticket.
Öt perc múlva kaput nyitunk, a közönséget engedjük befelé.
Queen made history at Neff Stadium. Not only by playing to the largest rock audience behind the Iron Curtain, but also by filming the event with all the available camera equipment in the country and the approval of the Hungarian government. Some still find time to relax on the roof terrace of Budapest Hotel.
What?
Sorry, this is you being manipulated. All these people around.
Fools in every direction.
Oh, God.
Thank you, Richard. You do what I mean?
Okay. We both those hanging in front.
They're great.
Yes. Let's keep it on, Richard.
Gets harder every time, you know. I think sort of like in terms of competition, I mean, there are lots of wonderful new bands and they seem to sort of come up with newer ideas and they're fresh and they've sort of, there's new technology and so like it's hard. You have to sort of be very aware, you know, and I feel I'm always on my toes. I like to sort of see what the new people are doing rather than just, because it's quite easy to say, you know, you did it 10 years ago and you can do the same old thing again. I hate doing the same things again. I like to see what's happening now and try and sort of incorporate all those kind of forms into Queen.
First started, we always had, we were future thinking in the fact that we wanted to do this, we wanted to tour here, we wanted to go there, we wanted our albums to be successful here and there and ever, you know, and we worked really hard at it. But in a strange way, now we have achieved that in a lot of countries in the world. It's does take away some of the incentive.
It seems like a long time since we began. Yeah, it seems unimaginable what's happened. I think we always had big egos. I don't know if that's the right word. We always believed that we had something special and that we could do anything that anyone else did. This kind of thing, you know, that's the kind of belief that kept us going in the early days. But I don't think we quite believed what would happen. I don't think we even knew what was possible. Old, rich, and useless.
Fuck today, tomorrow. I don't know why, and if you ask any of the other members, I don't know why we're together.
We think that in spite of all problems that we may have, that Queen is still something just kind of precious, because you can't make a group, which works. It happens, and if you're very lucky, it probably doesn't happen more than once in your life.
We've basically achieved what we wanted to do, I think, and we want to keep on doing it for a little while, and not just give up.
I think we all find it quite difficult now to actually sort of to do nothing, to laze around and do nothing. We all get, I don't think, we all get very bored and get fidgety and want to do something, work, which is good, I suppose, in a way.
It becomes harder because now it's like staying power, you know, like you have to sort of, because I was thinking, you know, somebody else asked me that the other day, Selena Scott, and like the question is like, you've achieved everything, what else is there?
I don't know, perhaps more of the same.
I know there'll be a time where I can't run around on stage because it'll be ridiculous, you know, and I know when there comes a time when you have to stop. But music will still be my thing. All we hear is Radio Gaga, Radio Goo, Radio Gaga. All we hear is Radio Gaga, Radio Goo, Radio Gaga.
I'm going probably through a very uncertain phase in my life at the moment. As part of the insecurities of being involved in the music business or in a band. All we hear is
Radio Gaga. If I could give them any advice, it would be don't break up. There's no need to break up. Just have a long holiday, but don't break up. Radio Goo,
Radio Gaga. The thing which holds us finally together is the fact that Queen is a lot better than any one of us.
Yes.
This chemistry that's worked has really worked for us, and so why, you know, why kill the goose that laid the golden egg? All we hear is Radio Gaga, Radio Gaga, Radio was to you, Radio, someone still loves you.
They've not been there as long as the Stones and the Who and bands like that. So the legend, those legends were sort of built in the 60s. They came in the second echelon, and maybe their legendary status hasn't been reached yet, but I'm sure in when the great rock and roll book is written at the turn of the century, they will be up there with the legends.
I had to do it all over again, yes, why not? Why not? I do it slightly differently.
King Mercury.
Long may she reign.
President Reagan, nobody,
not even you, sir.
And not even the Prime Minister of Yugoslavia.
That's ridiculous.
Just look at all those hungry mouths we have to feed. Take a look at all the suffering we need. So many lonely faces scattered all around, searching for.
January 1988. Queen go back into the studio. The story continues.